Welcome to Valley Grove Baptist Church, located at 1731 South, U.S. Highway 281 in Stephenville, Texas. We are glad you joined us for our 10:30 Sunday morning worship service. If you'd like to learn more about Valley Grove, please check us out at our website at valleygrove.net. Now, join us for the morning worship service already in progress.
Redeemed from the hand of the foe, gathered from the lands as far as from the east as the west and the north from the south. Let the redeemed of the Lord say this. You know what it means to have Jesus as part of our conversation this week? Is telling others what Jesus has done and is doing in our lives. That's all it means. And Scripture tells us, hey, the redeemed need to tell others what God is doing in our lives. Amen? Amen. We need to because we want to tell others about His great love for them as well. Right now, let's stand and greet one another in the love of Christ. Glad you're here this morning.
Blessed be your name, the sun is shining down on me, the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name.
Madison Garrett comes to follow through in obedience and baptism. Beautiful testimony to the faith of a family lived out before their children, but also a beautiful opportunity for us as a church family to remember that we surround these new believers, helping to disciple them and mentor them, encourage them, and pray for them. So as Addison comes this morning, you be in prayer for her, and you remember the call that you have to help to disciple and mentor her as she grows in her faith. Is that right? Ms. Addison, because you have publicly professed your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I baptize you as my sister in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Having died to a new life, being raised to new life. Pray with us. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for new life. We understand that what we celebrate today is only because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on our behalf. We celebrate with Addison and we remember our salvation, Father, and we give you thanks in all things. Father, may we be to her the mentors we need to be, you've called us to be. As she grows up in her body, Father, and grows up in her faith, help us to be that church family surrounding her and helping her in these things. Father, in all things we give you praise and thanks in Christ's name.
Jesus lives today. We can trust Him. Fill this temple with your presence. In your name we pray. Amen. God.
ask the ushers to come forward for offering time. Boys and girls, do you want to go back to the back there for our children's time? As the girls close to waiting back there. So boys and girls, you need that.
it's too good to be true, what? Probably is, right? Read a story this week of one that had gotten taken responding to online coupons for free $100 worth of groceries and this, that, and the other. And they paid for these coupons and found out they were fraudulent and worthless. Too good to be true, probably is. Other stories of ones call this number and win a free trip or a guaranteed amount of money or something. Too good to be true, it probably is. Unfortunately, those things happen. Even more unfortunate is sometimes we take the truth and the understanding of those things and we kind of pull those in the lens in which we understand Scripture or see God. Well, we don't do so intentionally sometimes. It just kind of happens. As we read about the beautiful grace of God and the promises of God, then all of a sudden we just kind of have this rolling around in the back of our mind. Man, it just sounds too good to be true. Perhaps that is one of the risks in the passage that I want to study this morning, Romans 8, 28. I know, I promise at the outset of our study of Romans, it was going to be a flyover from 30,000 feet. We were going to hit just major themes and go through it quickly. And I had intended to, and last week, and we just did one chapter, and it was chapter 8. And as I sat down to study this week and prepare for chapters 9, 10, and 11, I just couldn't get away from Romans 8, 28. In fact, Tuesday, as I was doing more prayer, three things, just where Romans 8, 28 was in front of me, just different in incredible ways, to where I knew that we needed to pause and anchor here for just a bit. So that's where we're going to be today, Romans 8, 28, if you want to turn there, as we'll begin here in just a moment. A beautiful passage, a wonderful passage, a passage with great truth, great promise, that I want us to spend a little time going back over again today. So as we begin, let's pray again. Gracious Father, we give you thanks for the truth of your word. And I pray, Lord, as we open your word this morning, that you open our minds, that we open our hearts, our minds to you, that we hear you speak to us. Father, I pray for a covering of your Holy Spirit over me, giving my voice strength, giving my mind quickness, and let the words that come out of my mouth be your words today, Father. But let the words that each one hears be what they need to hear from you today. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. I apologize for the frog in my throat and the sucker in my mouth. I think hopefully both of those will help us get through. But if you'll turn to Romans 8, 28 as we begin, Bobby, throw up that first slide there, that picture of the mountain. Romans 8 is a wonderful chapter, and one of the things that's going back through and studying it, I began to see this picture that the chapter, I think, conveys. It's a picture of this solid rock on which we can stand, this truth that we see there represented in the middle, which I think is the key not only to this chapter, but to much of our understanding of living out our faith, and that is this, that our present sufferings cannot compare to the glory of eternity in heaven. Okay? That's the rock. Because there's so much we're going to endure. In fact, you see on the sides of the mountain, in the parts of chapter 8, it begins and it kind of ends with this understanding of suffering, that we share in Christ's suffering if we are His followers. But also that our sufferings, nothing that we go through can separate us from the love of Christ. So there's this understanding that sufferings happen. But these sufferings are manageable. These sufferings we go through because we have this rock, that our present sufferings pale in comparison to the glory of heaven that we'll experience for eternity. Amen? I mean, that's something on which we can stand. That's something there that we can grasp onto and hold firmly to. We've talked about with the rope several times, the length of our time here versus the length of eternity. And we understand that this investment we're making here and our relationship with God not only has returns for here and now, but for all eternity. And it will pale in comparison this time to that. And so that's a rock, that's an anchor, that's a mountain on which we can stand and climb. But what crests this mountain? this beautiful mountain of promise and understanding. What caps the top of it is this, and I want you to read that together with me. For we know that in all things God is at work for the good of his followers, and they're called purpose. Now that's the New Living Ward Hayes translation there at the beginning, but or at the end, but the reason is that is because of the understanding, I think, that gives us. If I had it to do over again, I would title the sermon, rather than For We Know, I would title it Promise for the Righteous. Paul has a theme of righteousness throughout Romans. And this righteousness by faith. And here Paul gives us this capstone, this top of the mountain promise and understanding of our knowledge as righteous, not because of our own acts, but because of our faith in Jesus Christ. This beautiful promise that in everything that's happening in our life, God is at work. And not only is he at work, he's at work to bring about good in our lives for those that are his followers, those that are called according to his purpose. Now, one of the things we talk about in studying Scripture is that Scripture interprets Scripture. And so this isn't a single truth. This isn't a single time that we find this. And so one of the things I want us to do, first of all, is understand that this, for we know that God is at work to bring about good in all things, that we understand that this is seen throughout Scripture.
I apologize.
You can't swallow and breathe at the same time. Okay, here's the thing. Jesus told his followers, he's fixing to leave, he's fixing to die on the cross, and he says in John 14, verse 1, do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me. For in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go there and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you so that you may be where I am also. Okay? What's the truth in there? The truth, Jesus says, hey, there's going to be trouble. There's going to be difficulties. But understand that I'm coming back to get you so that we can spend eternity together. For we know that our present sufferings cannot compare to the eternal glory that we'll have with Jesus Christ. Amen? We also see it in 1 Corinthians 15, 19. It said, if it's only for this life that we have faith in Jesus Christ and not for eternity, we're pitied above all men. But that is not the case. We have faith in Jesus Christ that lasts all eternity, that goes beyond just this physical life. Again, an understanding that it anchors us, that eternity, that beautiful promise of being with God forever in eternity, anchors us for all the difficulties that we will face in our trials here on earth. But we also see the promise of the for we know that in all things God is at work. Consider this, the story of Hezekiah. Isaiah 38, if you want to turn there, Isaiah 38, verses 1 through 6. King Hezekiah experiences a calamity, a difficulty, an illness. And there he turns back to God and he says, God, I forgive me of my trespasses. Forgive me of the things that have been wrong. God grants him an extended period of time of his life. But then he says this in verse 17. This is the words of Hezekiah. Surely it was for my benefit that I suffered such anguish. What is it a recognition of? It's a recognition of that those things were difficult times. Those things were the tough trials and the tough illness. Surely it was for my benefit that I suffered these things, as I returned in relationship with God and received the blessing of it. Consider the story of Stephen, as we see it in Acts chapter 8. There's Stephen, martyred for his faith, martyred for his testimony of Jesus Christ as the crucified Lord, was stoned by the Pharisees, was stoned with Paul giving his approval and watching over. Now, how was that a good thing? What did God bring good from that? Well, it wasn't a good thing that Stephen was stoned. But from the difficulty of that stoning and from his death, the Christians of Jerusalem were scattered throughout Judea and Samaria and throughout the world. So from that difficult and difficult trial, that act of evil, God brought about good, because with them, whenever they went to those places, Judea, Samaria, and the other parts of the world, they took the gospel of Jesus Christ with them. And all of a sudden, those disciples and those evangelists began to spread out around the world. And so the message of Christ began to reach places in the world that had never been before. Because God brought good from the difficulty of that situation. Esther 4:14, a verse that we quote oftentimes as Esther is told by our uncle. There says, perhaps you were put in this time and this place for for such a time as this. There she was, given a position of leadership, in essence, as a queen and influence over the king. In a difficult time, they were going to kill the Jews, but out of that difficult time, God was glorified and honored, and she understood the purpose for which God had presented her in life. We see the truth of it in the story of Jesus. Acts 2:36, the disciples testify this to the Pharisees. God has made Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ, Lord and Messiah. So out of Christ's crucifixion is salvation presented to the world. What you meant for evil, God turned into good. For we know that in all things God is at work for the good of his followers and those that are called according to his purpose. Not all things are good, but God is always at work in them to bring good about for his followers, even in the sufferings of life. Amen?
Amen?
Amen? Amen. It is a truth and a promise, not too good to be true, a truth and a promise that we must hold on to, that we must anchor our faith and life in. Now, it stands firmly on the understanding that our present sufferings pale in comparison to the glory of eternity with Christ. But it sits there with this understanding that even in our difficult times, even in the hardest of times, God is at work to bring about good in our lives. Sunday night, I've been having a wonderful study with Ray Vanderlaan. I want to present you a couple of minutes of study from this last Sunday night. He's going to share some of this in a little different way. But hear closely his words. Bobby, would you run that video for me?
Life is this path. Now, look at the path around you for a moment. Notice it. I particularly liked this path because it is hard. In fact, we picked a place on the path that's actually easier than where we've been walking. Life isn't a sidewalk. I wish I could tell you that if you prayed enough, God would come and pave it. Curbs on either side. It's not what it's like, and you know that, and I know that. There are stretches like that, praise Him. But that's not often what life is like. Life is like this path. And in the Bible, there are something called stones of stumbling. For example, he will give his angels a command to watch you on all your paths, ways we say, to lift you up so you don't strike your foot against a stone. Look around your feet once. Let me tell you, hiking in this country, you better have marathon ankles because there are tons of stumbling stones. So let's go with that metaphor a minute. Notice, on life's path, there are little stones, like these. They're more annoying than anything else. You step on them wrong, you turn an ankle. But nobody's going to get seriously hurt by one of these. They're just annoying. And life is like that. Your job isn't going exactly right. You're struggling with an issue with your children. You know, the things in life that we carry around, but we say, well, if that's all the burdens I ever had, I can probably live with that. But then notice, as you walk, there are much bigger stones. Like this. You stumble into one of those, it hurts. And things happen in life of a much bigger nature. You lose that job. Your child goes through a difficult time in life. You have a disease that you struggle to get better from by the grace of God. And then sometimes there are these stones. And one of those brings you to your knees. I don't know what it is for you, but we could all describe those moments where you're just stopped in your tracks. And you say, I don't know if I can keep going. And then sometimes, well, I suppose it's a little bit like this. And you come up against one of these, and you say, there's no way. Your spouse goes to be with God. One of your children walks away from the faith. Someone you love has a terminal disease. You stand and you say, God, there's no way. There's no way over. There's no way around. But listen to an amazing promise in light of the fact that life is a walk on a path. God says in Psalm 81, if my people would but listen to me, if Israel would walk in my ways, if only you would be on my path, it's not any easier. God doesn't say, you know what, choose my path and I'll clear the rocks out. It's a hard path sometimes. Ask the Israelites. Ask Jesus. Ask the person next to you. But if you would only walk on my path, you would be fed with the finest wheat, and I would satisfy you, listen to this, with honey from the rock.
Jesus was doing that, and so help that person understand who Jesus was.
But the truth of the matter is that outside of God, we don't have an understanding. We don't have the capacity, to understand good. God alone is good. And God alone understands what good is. Now we can learn from Him, but He is the source of understanding what good is. I'm sure it's probably a universal truth, a universal teaching of all parents to teach kids not to mess with flames, right? I mean, if you put your hand on a hot burner or over a flame, it's going to hurt. But now you don't go to all the details with them. You don't say, well, you know, the temperature of this will do this to your skin. It'll create this kind of blister. It'll create this kind of damage in your skin. And this, we don't go into all that detail. All we tell them is, that's bad for you, right? Universal truth. And so we know, as we teach our children, you don't play with these things, right? Everybody probably understands that. Does every human being really understand that? No. Bobby, put that picture up for me. Picture on the left is a gentleman filling his gas with car. Or, excuse me, with gas. Very quick in my mind. He is deathly afraid of spiders, apparently. And a spider has crawled up onto the hose that he's filling his car with. And so he takes out his lighter to burn the spider so that it will not be on there anymore. The picture on the right is the result of that. Now, I'm sure his parents told him, don't play with fire, and don't play with lighters, right? And he said he understood it, but apparently he didn't really understand all that there was, right? Bless his heart, he was safe. I think the car was, too. I don't think the spider made it. I think ultimately what he wanted to happen happened, and that is the spider was no more. Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. God told them, don't eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And sometimes we think, why? What's it going to hurt for them to eat it? What's it going to hurt for them to gain knowledge? The same scenario that the serpent used. Is it really going to be bad for you? Will you really die if you eat of that fruit? Oh, God just doesn't want you to be like Him. He just doesn't want you to understand what good truly is. The truth is, God knew they couldn't handle it. They couldn't handle the full knowledge of good because they didn't have that capacity. God did. And God shared that with them enough for them to know, this right here will not benefit you, but they had it anyway. God came down to visit them. They were embarrassed and ashamed because they were naked. Had their situation changed in the spot that they weren't naked before God beforehand? No. They had a different kind of knowledge, a different knowledge now. Now some of it was their sin, certainly, and the shame of that sin. But you know, the truth of it too was they had a different understanding of a different knowledge they couldn't handle. God didn't go through and tell them all the reasons why don't eat of that tree. He said, I just told you, don't eat of that tree. That's enough. He understood what they didn't. God gives us guidelines, these rules, these expectations. Why? Because he's a big meanie? No, because He understands what we don't. He understands what good truly is. And whenever God says, I'm at work in your life to bring good from a situation, we go, how possibly can good come from this? And He goes, just trust me. I know what good is. I know what good is even when you don't. I'm not saying the situation is good, but I'm going to bring good from it. Trust me. Keep your anchor in me. Let me tell you what good is and trust me that I'm going to work to bring it about. How many of you used to watch Hee-Haw growing up? Yeah? You know, like Archie Campbell there in the barbershop? He had a skit there of, oh, that's good, no, that's bad. I don't know if you ever remember watching that. But we're going to do something similar to that because I want to tell you the story of Joseph and see how it is with us understanding what is good and what is bad. But I need your help, okay? So when I give you the thumbs up, I need you to say, oh, that's good. And when I give you the thumbs down, I need you to say, oh, that's bad. Okay? We're going to practice once. You ready?
Oh, that's good.
You guys are good.
Oh, that's bad.
Perfect. Here's the story. The story of Joseph. Joseph was the baby of 12 boys.
Oh, that's bad.
No, that's good. Because even though that's generally the oldest that has the best birthright, Joseph was his father Jacob's favorite. No, that's bad. Because as a favorite, he was hated by his brothers. He even had dreams prophesying of their submission to him. So one day they were in the field and his brothers talked of killing Joseph. No, that's good. Because they only talked of killing him. They said, let's don't kill him, because after all, he is our brother. So they threw him into a pit instead.
Oh, that's good.
No, that's Because when they saw a band of traitors coming, they decided to sell Joseph into slavery. No, that's good. Because the traitors took him to Egypt, far away from his mean old brothers. No, that's bad. Because it was far away from his father, too. And his brothers told his father that his favorite son had died. And it was over 20 years before they would see each other again. No, that's good. Because in those 20 years, Joseph had risen up to become the second in command of Egypt, which was when a horrible famine struck the area, not only where Abraham and his family lived, but also Egypt. Joseph was in a position to save his family from starvation.
Oh, that's good.
Yes, that is good. Joseph told his brothers, "What you meant for me for evil, God meant for good." And when his brothers threw him in the pit, they sold him into slavery, no one would have called it good. And it wasn't good. It was an evil thing that they did. But God took that evil event and he brought good from it. Now for 20 years, God was at work in ways that Joseph and his brothers didn't fully see and understand. And yet at the end of those 20 plus years, when God brought it to fruition, Joseph had the wisdom of God to say, "You meant it for evil long ago, but God brought good from it." Because that is the God we serve. For we know that in all things, God is at work for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. Amen? So God tells us what is good. The third question is this: where is my anchor? I would put that picture of the mountain up again for you. Who is God we've talked about? What is good? And now we talk about where is my anchor. Romans 8:28 is conditional. We talk about many things as unconditional. The love of God for all mankind, wanting all to come to a knowledge of salvation. But understand this. Romans 8:28 is conditional. And the conditions are this: that God is at work in the lives of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. It does not say that God is at work to bring good about for every person across the earth. That is not what it says. The truth is, God is at work wanting to draw all mankind unto himself and wanting all to be in relationship. Yes. But this promise of Romans 8:28, in talking about the sufferings that we endure and the sufferings that we will go through as we are anchored in the rock of our present sufferings, not comparing to eternity with Christ, is anchored in the two conditions of those who love him and who are called to his purpose. Condition one, those who love him. Who are those that love him? Jesus said, "If you love me, you obey my commands." So we understand that followers of Christ are obedient followers of Christ, ones that follow and seek his will, his ways, and seek to emulate Christ in all that they say and do. So it is his followers. It is not his pretenders. It is his followers. The second condition is this: those that are called according to his purpose. Those that are seeking to fulfill the plans that God has for their lives. Not those that sit in his lordship over their own lives, sitting that throne. They've yielded that throne to Christ. And so they seek his purpose for their lives. Jeremiah 29:11, a beautiful promise that we often claim and cling to, says this. God says, "For I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you, to give you a hope and a future." God didn't say, "I know the plans you have for yourself, and hey, man, I'll bless them and hope they go well for you." He said, "No, I know the plans I have for you." Such as it is in Romans 8:28, those that are called according to his purpose, the purpose that he has for our lives. Romans 8:28 is not too good to be true. It's a beautiful promise from God. But the truth of it is this, that we must be anchored in his call and his ways. It's conditional upon us being followers of his, and not just a promise for everyone around the world. It's also conditional in understanding that we need to be patient for his timing. For Joseph, it took over 20 years to see and understand what God was doing in his life. I don't know how long it's going to take in your life. But I do know that God is at work for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. We are called to be patient, called to be trusting, called to be understanding that he is at work, and that is the truth. And we hold firmly to that and trust that he is at work in our lives. The third thing is this, that we trust in that he has the power to make it happen. God is able
to bring good from any situation. God is able to take a situation that is truly evil and to bring good from it. Good that will change not only your life, but many of those around you. Romans 8:28 is a beautiful promise. It gives us a beautiful understanding better of who God is. It helps us understand this anchor that we have, that our present sufferings or trials, whatever we go through, will always pale in comparison to eternity with God. And it gives us a beautiful understanding and reminder that He is the only one worthy of our trust, worthy of our worship, worthy to put our anchor in. Amen?
Amen.
Where's your anchor? Where's your trust? What's your level of patience? What's your focus? Who's on the throne? Questions today that we ask ourselves as we seek to live out this promise.